And our guest speaker today is very knowledgeable in building his advanced strategies. And so in his advanced strategies, the example of the STILMAN is a very intelligent software tools developed by STILMAN for the U.S. Army and currently vital for the U.S. National Defense. And he's won numerous awards and competitive. And even the SBIR, I was very impressed with that, the Small Business Innovative Research Award, which is very hard research grant to obtain funding for. He's also been very active in various governmental projects, and so he wanted me to keep it short because today he said a lot of his talk is going to focus on what he's done with this information and how he's built his company. So I want to thank Dr. Boris Stillman, and please come and tell us more about turning idea into real-world systems and personal experience.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this introduction, and bon appetit. And I hope not to disturb so much your breakfast, but let me try. This is a very unusual talk for me. Usually I talk about my research, and this time about building a company. And in my school, I'm not sure so much about other schools, this is not so much appreciated, what I'm doing. Probably understand that university wants what? Money. And if it doesn't get them, then it's a kind of semi-hostile environment. That's what really happens. Of course, many universities have a framework for this, like big schools, even our school for on the medical campus. But if you are outside of this framework, outside of sharing IP, intellectual property, and everything else, then you are a host. Essentially, you are not welcome in that sense. But around the world also research, research, and research. And many professors, I would say, especially in the former Eastern Bloc, don't really understand the value of practical approach. And from the very beginning, I should tell you that for me, this company is just another type of research. I would say it's number one research of what I was doing for many years. And what I'm doing in the department is number two. So it's nothing about integration. It is just extension of my research. Okay, let's begin from the beginning. Maybe it makes sense also to mention that about my background, because I'm originally from the former Soviet Union. There was no Russia at that time, the Soviet Union. In 91, I moved to the West, actually in 1990. I spent 1 year at McGill University in Canada, in Montreal, and then since 91, I've been a professor of computer science at the University of Colorado. So it's 26 years. Yeah. And I never thought about building a company. So I just a scientist. I was a scientist in the Soviet Union in Moscow and continued to be a scientist and professor at the University of Colorado. And my research goes back to Russia because I've been doing this research for 18 years back in Moscow and continued at the University of Colorado. I'll explain a little bit about this. Actually, I was talking about this yesterday, but today I will also mention to some extent. So the point is that today I will tell you how it was built. Of course, to tell you everything, it would take forever. But some major points which I decided to highlight. Let's begin from the beginning. You can see very strange day, but that's just coincidence. That's how it happened. Why it doesn't? Okay. Strange. I'm with the University of Colorado, and what you see here, Tulane University, it's New Orleans, Louisiana, and this happened exactly 18 years ago at this time during the spring break. I was invited for interview for endowed chair. Probably you know, I'm not sure about foreigners in here, what endowed chair means. They put some money in the bank, and the interest from this money goes as a salary to the professor. Why is it called Yahoo? Of course, you know the Yahoo website. One of the founders, there are two of them, of this Yahoo website was kind of got very rich, as you understand, and he decided to establish endowed chair in his native school. And he put money, and they announced competition for this. So somehow they invited me for this interview. And that's what was happening during the spring break. I was traveling from Denver, Colorado to New Orleans, gave several talks because that's where was the condition for this interview, for this endowed chair, and promised them golden mountains, everything you can imagine, much less than what was later implemented with the company. Of course, I never thought about any company at that time. They did not believe me, of course. The main thing what I learned from them is they hated each other, I mean the departmental faculty. And of course, we were talking about many different things, but they did not extend an offer to me. Of course, not at once, but later on. So when I was coming back to Denver, already at that time, it was a message, an email message on my laptop. Not, I didn't have even a laptop at that time, from a local entrepreneur in Colorado. He was a, I would call it, serial entrepreneur, and he was famous with such things on the right. He's a pretty young guy. That he failed everything he started. That's very typical for many so-called serial entrepreneurs. Some of them, of course, very successful. Unfortunately, I never met those, just watched on TV. But this guy promised again anything you could imagine. He told me that my students informed him about what my research back in the Soviet Union, then in the University of Colorado. This is something amazing, and we should start the company. This was not the first request of this kind. I had some friends. They worked in industry, one at Rockwell Science Center in Southern Oaks, California, the other one in Texas. And then a professor in our school who tried to persuade me to start the company. What was the purpose? To test research, to test the results. Because it was mostly theory. The theory that I developed, it's called linguistic geometry, try to implement this for real world applications. And I was very hesitant. Not really hesitant, I just flatly denied this. Because I'm not a businessman, I'm just a scientist, I cannot do all this. And this entrepreneur was very persuasive. So I would just try. And about his failures, I never heard of this. So I did not even know what he was accomplished. But he presented himself as a very experienced person who knows how to do this, who knows everything what he told me, he learned from the book. He was reading all the time. And it looked very interesting. But of course, he did not persuade me at that time. What you see in here is a picture from Denver Post, our main Colorado newspaper. They actually took this picture. You can see it looks nice. And the title of the article, "Firm Aims to Checkmate the Enemy." Checkmate because my background is actually a computer chess programming. That's what I was doing in Russia, in the Soviet Union, and that's what the Soviet government actually paid for. It's very surprising, but the idea was to understand how grandmasters search without search, how they solve complex problems, and transfer this general approach to different domains. That was actually a paying job. And the results were very interesting, and that's the approach which I continued developing in Colorado, and that's what this journalist was told, and that's how she decided to title the article. If you also notice the date when it was published, it was exactly 1 month after 9/11. The actual interview, I hope for foreigners know what 9/11 is. So, was at, in the morning of 9/11. So, of course, it was canceled, and it happened a little bit later, but 1 month later, this article was published. So, it was very, very popular at that time in Denver. The company was tiny at that time already, in 2001. So, this another event which actually happened at the same time, in the summer of 99. I got a good student. To say good would be just not enough, probably, not sufficient. University of Colorado, of course, famous with good students, but not our campus. Boulder, that's the main campus of University of Colorado. This is Denver. And when I arrived first time in Denver and in our department, I realized it is something almost like a village for me, because I knew Moscow State University environment. Just to give you an idea, every day it was about 50 different seminars, just in math department alone, 50, all different. When I arrived at McGill, I could see maybe 3 to 4 during 1 day. At University of Colorado Denver, it was none. So just to give you an idea about all this. And our students were mostly professionals, where they were coming to get a paper, to get a master's degree, for example, and that's it. They were not really interested in research. And I had been experiencing this for eight years before all this happened. So suddenly this student was really great. I can probably talk about this too much, but let's go further. This picture is taken a little bit later, and what you see in there is just a computer. Computer which usually installed in military vehicles. This is actually in a Striker. The screen and the computer itself. This all looks like water pipes, but these are cables. At the same time, in the summer of 99, I finished a manuscript of my book called Linguistic Geometry, and you can see the summary of this, that the theory is a new type of game theory, and it actually replaces search by construction, making these games, which are usually considered intractable, computationally tractable. So, it was published in 2000. Actually, I gave this book, manuscript, to this student who never took class with me in linguistic geometry. He took in artificial intelligence because that was a standard undergraduate course. And he read manuscript, and I think within 1 month. And I asked him, do you have questions? He said, not yet. But he actually read it, and I said, when you have questions, ask me. And he never did. He actually understood everything himself. This was extremely surprising to me, because I know that many professors, many scientists actually read it and did not really get through completely, but he did. And the main thing which actually also happened in the summer of 99, this is about DARPA and about this grant. I, with my friends from Rockwell International, from Texas, and with other professors, have been applying for those grants for several years. I'm not sure, especially foreigners, know how hard it is to get those grants, no matter from NSF or from military. But we got refusals, of course, consistently. And what really happened at that time? Sometimes I was the prime, sometimes my friends were primes, I mean Rockwell International. But this time Rockwell was the prime, and we got this grant. It was $1.5 million. For DARPA, it's not big, it's very small. $1.5 million for year and a half. But for a professor, it's huge, of course. And so the team was Rockwell International, then University of Colorado, Cornell University, and Wayne State University, a subcontractor. And we decided this is the moment. Everything comes together. This entrepreneur, good student who has to be involved. Of course, I didn't know his programming skills, but I thought he is very, very special. My friends who keep persuading me to organize the company and this grant. We have to start the company. Again, university was not involved at all. There was no infrastructure for this year at that time in 99 on our campus. So we did start this. We thought that we'll take some money from this, or maybe somehow. Of course, we didn't know all the details. That's how it actually started. My chunk of this money was about $160,000 for 1 year as a professor of University of Colorado. And I certainly could not use this money for the company. University has a lot of restrictions on this. I actually did not even know how I will spend this money. The only thing which could be done is just summer salary, 3 months. You know that American faculty are not paid in the summer. They are on a 9 month salary. So it was great success. Now maybe a few words about Joint Force Air Component Commander. That's the title of this project. It is an attempt to automate the so-called strike package, which has to break the enemy's defense. So a group of airplanes flying and probe and actually break the enemy's defense, and then all other airplanes flew through this hole. So the idea was to make it completely automated. Of course, employing artificial intelligence, if possible. And this should have been the first application of linguistic geometry, so the linguistic geometry should have been the foundation of this approach, despite of multiple participants of this grant. And we founded the company. If you think it is hard, no way. It is so simple to establish the company. Just look at this. This is the Articles of Organization. You go to the Colorado State Secretary, submit this application, and you can see I try to magnify this. So it's $9,999, and we paid $50, and that's it. Very, very simple. It is just formal step. So these are participants, interesting set of participants, of so-called managers of the company. Four PhDs, one serial entrepreneur, and one student, of course, was not listed. That's all. That's the company. But the main thing was we expected money from this grant. How? Because the manager at Rockwell, who was in charge, of course, promised that some money will be allocated to your company because somebody has to develop software and implement everything. Everyone knew that they did not know linguistic geometry, they could not do that. I had just this one student, and I thought that this will be the foundation for the new company and for the development. So this is the main building of Rockwell International, of Rockwell Science Center in Thousand Oaks, California, and these are participants of this grant. I already mentioned all of them. Maybe you heard about government bureaucracy in USA. But you probably never heard about the defense bureaucracy. It is, I would say, the government bureaucracy squared. That's what it is. And of course, I didn't know all such things at that time. So the negotiations between Rockwell and university and all these universities continued for 4 months just for distributing this money. And one of the participants at Cornell, he was a very famous mathematician, Anil Nirod, in math logic and some other stuff. And he was completely pissed off with this procedure. So he could not stand all this. He had some other grants. He decided to drop from this because he did not want to continue with DARPA and with Rockwell Science Center. And what really happened? Then, only then, Rockwell Science Center decided to give part of his chunk of money to establishing the company. Only at that time, after 4 months. Of course, during these 4 months, we founded September 9, and sometime in the beginning of 2001, in January, that's when this actually happened. So the company was without money completely during these 4 months. I was very angry at my friend who worked at Rockwell. I thought he maybe lied, but it was his manager who actually lied all this time. So finally, money has come, about the same chunk as I got as professor. And the company was founded. The entrepreneur who was in charge of all the business at that time immediately spent all this money, probably within half a year. We bought computers, we bought a big table where he should be sitting, or some rented office and all this. So money was burned immediately. And what about university? What you see in here is actually University of Colorado. It's kind of more or less modern view. Not this building, of course. This is a Four Seasons Hotel. So this building, this one, we are on the 8th floor, Department of Computer Science. We are kind of in downtown Denver. And I wrote a letter to Vice Chancellor saying that I'm going to establish the company, and she responded, yes, you can do this, but you have to follow all the regulations about this. The other big thing which actually happened, this entrepreneur kind of explained to us, only investors could help you for company to survive. There is no way you would exist without this external money. And for the first 2 years, probably every 2 weeks, I gave presentations to different investors. I'm not sure you ever dealt with investors or venture capitalists, how they call them. But my impression is very bad. In what sense? These are gods on this planet. They know everything. Of course, they have money. And they would, whatever you tell them, they will teach you how to live, how to build the company, not simply build the company, everything what you want, you could think about. So you are nobody in front of them. And this impression was very consistent because, as I said, I gave many different talks. It doesn't mean that they just refused outright. They said, for example, like this, it was the year of 2000, for example. It was internet explosion, if you recall at that time. So they said, yeah, it's very interesting what you're telling us, but is there any relationship of what you're doing to internet? I said, no, not directly, but to some extent. Okay, if you establish this relationship, we can think about it. Because that's what they thought. Internet is everything, everything else is nothing, especially in software development. That's how it was. And this is just minor, but in general, they taught me how to continue, what needs to be done, in which direction. And I felt myself like an elementary school student in front of them. No matter what I achieved and what I plan, and we had this grant from DARPA, they were not really interested in all this. But in addition, what I was told, that you have to provide some kind of independence of your intellectual property from the university. It was actually a very founded, very well-established idea to create this independence of intellectual property because the history of development was quite long, many years in the former Soviet Union, then at McGill University, then 8 years at the University of Colorado, and most importantly, everything was published. Almost everything was published. If something is published, there is no intellectual property on this. So, For 2 years, we tried to persuade university management to kind of give away their rights on intellectual property, on my research, on linguistic geometry, for 2 years. And for somehow, probably they maybe made a mistake because the management changed. But after 2 years of struggle, this happened. If you can read, I'm sure too, it's a typed document that the regents of University of Colorado agreed not to seek rights for the software prototype developed at Stillman Advanced Strategies. It's very limited agreement. Of course, prototype was very undeveloped at that time, and we are not talking about the whole approach, but at least something. And that's what was established. And that I was told that only in this case, investors would pay attention to what you are doing. And it will be great in the future. That's how it happened. And also you can see this, some other regulations that I should not use university equipment, software development was not part of my employment, and that so-called 1/6 rule, that I should devote only 1/6 of my time to the company, of course, as a university professor. It's all, of course, virtual requirements, but that's, of course, needs to be obeyed. And it was considered unbelievable success at that time. Usually, universities never give up any kind of right, no matter where it is developed, when it is developed, but probably it was a mess at the university management at that time. So, we thought, companies established, we have such a great achievement with DARPA. Our performance at DARPA was very good. I would say exceptional. Of course, a different story how it was done, how this project was going on. It would again take forever. But we thought after getting this money from DARPA, new contracts will come. So we become famous, well-established, money will be pouring into us. How naive we were, very naive. Investors, I already mentioned that. That's what I was doing. So it was essentially failure after failure. They did not invest. I think to a great extent, they didn't like our entrepreneurs who was involved in all this. They just, several times they told me in person that first get rid of him and then we will continue talking to you. But he of course learned about this and he immediately rejected those investors. That's how it was happening many, many times. And honestly, I should tell you that we did not get investment money. We didn't get any external money, and I'm really happy of that. What really happened is, I'm not sure you're aware of this, investors of course look for money, for multiplications of money. For example, they invest in 10 companies. They usually do this on multiple, on great scale. Normally, 9 out of 10 companies fail. How do they fail? They do not multiply money which investors put into this company. So for example, 3 years, if money is not multiplied, if it stays flat or maybe doubled, it's not enough. They kill the company. How do they kill? They take money back, their chance. That's it, then company dies immediately. Only 1 out of 10. And they don't really care what would be the profile of this company. So whatever makes money, that's good. That's for them. And for me, company was not money at all. For me, it was just extension of my research, trying to implement this in real life and to extend it, to see if it really works. Okay, what really happened? You may not also know that, but big companies, big sharks like Boeing, Lockheed, and some others have so-called spies. We cannot say spies, but they oversee what is happening in these big defense agencies. And when we were participating in this big project, JPAT, some people from Boeing, Lockheed were kind of working around. And it was very public. We had presentations actually every month. That's how DARPA structured this in different cities around the country. And we always see these people around. So Boeing guys noticed our performance. And one of them started talking to me and said, we might be interested in some joint development. So come to us, and we started flying to Seattle. That's where the Boeing headquarters was at that time. So some small contracts started, and that's who actually helped us to survive at that time. Not only, but very small contracts. What was the idea? In 2001, Iraq was still the enemy of not only the United States, the enemy of the world, I would say. It still threatened Kuwait after 10 years before when it was first war with Saddam Hussein. In 2001, it was still threatened. So Boeing decided to develop unsolicited proposal to the Air Force of the following contract. Let's assume that Saddam Hussein would acquire cruise missiles and would try to attack Kuwait. How to defend Kuwait in the optimal fashion? The most often, with ships, with airplanes, with anti-missile devices, and so on. And employing our software, you could simulate future battle and optimize this resource distribution. Resource distribution in terms of weaponry and different ships and planes and so on. So we demonstrated this and perfected from one demonstration to another. Boeing was very happy because it wanted to provide this to the government and get real money from the government to develop this on a grander scale. And we've been getting some money for this. Another thing, you mentioned SBIR when you introduced me. SBIR, Small Business Innovation Research. It is a very popular source of funding in the United States. Of course, I didn't know that before. Mostly in defense. Nowadays, they have from NSF, they have from for their health, but at that time, it was mostly defense. Many small businesses in the United States exists just using this money. How does it structure? Phase one, phase two, and phase three. Phase one is what, about 70,000 for half a year. Now it's about 100,000. The idea of this phase one is to prepare a proposal for phase two, essentially. It's kind of a well-established proposal. And phase two is more solid money. It is about half a million. Now it's a little bit more for 2 years. It's not really big money, but many companies, as I said, in the United States just use phases two, from one phase two to another, and exist this way. Of course, they have to innovate. And that's where real innovation comes from. Please don't think that Lockheed, Boeing, Northrop Grumman really do a lot of innovation. These small businesses do innovation. And if Lockheed, for example, would see some new thing in this small business, they buy it. They buy this whole small business and it becomes part of this Lockheed company. That's where innovation and how this innovation goes. And I've seen this so many times. We did not want to be sold. And at some point, there were some discussions with Boeing, but we just denied this outright. We want to be ourselves, we want to develop linguistic geometry and to test it and to do multiple experiments, but not to disappear. Because typically what happens when company is bought, it completely disappears. Even if the big company establishes a department titled with the name of this company, it is completely different environment. And what is really interesting, the members of this company will be gone. They typically go away. because the environment of big business is absolutely different from the environment of small business. So we won several phases one. Phases one, it's 70,000. But we never managed to get into phase two. I think we had 8 different phases one in missile defense, in Air Force, in the Army, in the Navy, never phase two. We, every time we were recommended, we had endorsement letters, but if everything in this world would be based on merit, this world will be different, unfortunately. So no matter what was happening, how excited program managers were who managed our phases one, how they promised us, nothing. And this was continued till 2004, for 5 years. Just phases one and Boeing helped. It wasn't really help. Boeing was very happy. Now, in such discussions probably, in such presentations, people never talk about failures. But because it is establishing the company, I'm going to talk about failures, because these failures teach us what might happen and what usually happens. In 2003, we had a real crisis, and we existed already for 4 years. One of my friends came from Rockwell. We were completely paid by the company. Of course, his salary immediately was like a rock with the company. We had to pay. We didn't have money for that. And we had 2 software developers, just 2. So 4 PhDs and 2 software developers. This was a very interesting project by DARPA. It supposedly has to be a continuation of the previous JFAC project. You can see mixed initiative control of automotive teams. It's called MICA. We were so well established with DARPA that everybody thought that we must get it. We applied, of course, submitted proposals. Just look at this, at our team. STILMAN is the prime. Tiny, tiny, tiny company. Boeing, subcontractor to STILMAN. They were so sure that we'll get it because they loved our approach very much. Rockwell Science Center, subcontractor. Cornell University, subcontractor. Our university, of course, and some other small companies. All of them believed in this. When I walked to DARPA and I saw, of course, it's called pre-proposal meeting. Many different businesses, even some universities, approached me and said, are you interested in joining? We want to join you. We want to join you. And I was walking around saying, no, we have already a big team. No, we are not really interested. So all of us were sure we'll get it. No way. We didn't get it. It was a huge failure, of course, for us, because we expected this. And we believed in this. So if you think about inheritance, that once you establish, you can continue. No way, no such thing. Okay, 2003. Boeing submitted an unsolicited proposal to the Air Force. It was called TAFE, Transformational Air and Space Expeditionary Force. They loved our approach, and it has to be a core of it. Of course, they put some kind of antenna for $150 million into this, put on the plane, but it was a proposal directly to the Chief of Staff of the Air Force. His name was General Jumper, four-star general. They even advertised or demonstrated our program to him, and he called it chess program. I don't know why, because of our chess background. So he also liked it. What really happened? Our chunk of this 150 million, I think, was 3.5 million. For us, it was astronomic amount at that time. Lockheed put a threat that this was unsolicited proposal, and this is not on competitive basis. So Air Force was scared because of the lawsuit. And it went nowhere. So Boeing failed. And we failed with Boeing. In this, it was still 2003. So this is TAFE team. Imagine the team of this. Look at this. Boeing, of course, in the center of this. General Dynamics, probably you heard about this, Big Shark, Northrop Grumman, BAE Systems, all of these are companies comparable to Boeing. It's a huge defense contractor. And this little guy failed. Everything failed. This is the whole team failed. 2003. We got this money. We got this grant. It's called Linguistic Geometry for Human Performance Enhancement. Of course, these are not million, but 700,000 still. But also, you may not heard about such things, that sometimes you get an award with zero money. Such things happen. Of course, in the beginning, 700,000, but then money is gone. It happened. So, all this during 1 year. Another one. We had established some relationship with UK. At that time, in 2003, British decided to modernize its aircraft carrier fleet. Instead of three aircraft carriers, two aircraft carriers, they were completely outdated, the previous, and they decided to build new. In a sense, similar to American, this is actually American aircraft carrier, but more automated with less people, and most importantly, forward-looking, looking into the future. Two groups of companies established teams. One led by BAE Systems in essentially Alinea Marconi at that time. And the other one by Thales. These are very big companies. In Europe, they have branches in the United States. Both teams learned that we can model the structure of the future aircraft carrier employing linguistic geometry and immerse the simulated aircraft carrier in the future battles. And then we could reveal possible deficiencies or advantages of this new construction. And they were very interested in this because they wanted to optimize the structure of this aircraft carrier. They started negotiating with us. We were extremely happy. We already got all these failures, which I mentioned before. We even hired one software developer without even getting new money. The guy was working at UPS, so probably he was very happy, and he became a student at the University of Colorado. The next day he came to me and said, "Could you increase my salary?" I think we paid him something like 2,500 a month. I said, "I would be happy to, but we don't have money. Once we got something, we will increase." And what really happened, we started already developing something without any money from them. British government made very bad things, for us especially. They awarded both teams of companies. To continue development of the new structure of aircraft carrier together. Immediately, these teams lost any interest in optimization, employing linguistic geometry. So it was another failure for us. So just look at this aircraft carrier, this Air Force grant, Boeing team, and MICA. All this during 1 year of 2003. We were ready to die, the whole company, because we expanded a little bit and we could not pay salary. I'm not sure you understand this, that if a faculty at the university doesn't get a grant, it's not a death. Maybe immediate promotion, maybe something else, but still, he won't die. He would have tenure, by the way, or not tenure, it doesn't matter. But for the company, if such failure happens, it's dead, especially without investors. How could we survive? I put, of course, some personal money. This was the first time I'd done this. The first time the other professor put some money because we had to pay salaries, otherwise we closed. And actually Boeing saved us. It was not that Boeing was so interested in doing this. It just happened. They wanted again to submit proposal to DARPA, and they wanted to demonstrate advantages of so-called repositionable satellites. Satellites which change their inclination of orbit. Then they provide, they may appear over the special regions, this is about intelligence satellites, much faster than in case of they could only raise their orbits. So we demonstrated all this, again, it's like simulation-based acquisition approach, like with aircraft carrier. And they were very happy and demonstrated this at DARPA. Of course, they didn't get anything, but they paid us for, from their R&D money. Not much, but helped to survive. So this was the end of 2003. Now I want some to give you some ideology about all this. It looks like we were just working like on a mundane basis. I could not imagine when we started this company how important this for my research. I could not imagine this huge loop, linguistic geometry and application. It's obvious that linguistic geometry, the theory generates application, but it's maybe not so obvious that there is a feedback that applications allow to extend the theory of linguistic geometry, and this goes on and on. What you see in here, this list, is the multiplicity of different problem domains which were discovered as a result of this company. Not, it doesn't mean that we implemented all this. Many stayed as prototypes. Others just as proposals, but this is a really new universe for us. That's how it was. It is not integration of practice and research. This is the first-rate research, a continuation of this. And we were, of course, we are very excited. Of course, the question is, how did I get time for doing all this? But I always consider this number one research. Because it is still research. Imagine you develop something as a faculty and, for example, Lockheed Martin takes this and develops this and implements this. In this case, it was Stillman which takes this and just gives a prototype, and then Boeing or Lockheed or somebody else or just the Air Force would take and experiment with this. At some point, we had four or five different experiments happening all around the country and in UK. Later on, of course. So it's special kind of excitement which you get with your research, and you immediately get feedback, and you get thoughts how to develop this, how to extend all this. So it's a totally different level. It doesn't mean that university doesn't understand this. They don't want to admit. That's how it is. So let me just mention. Information fusion. Of course, there are many things. Typically, what happens with information fusion, they get a lot of sensors around. That's, you can watch this on TV, in newspapers. So you have to put sensors everywhere, maybe in here as well. But what to do with this volume of information? They cannot really fuse this information together because they don't know how to do that. We provide the real high-level information fusion in terms of we take this all this information and generate courses of action. What the commander has to do. And predict the enemy's behavior. So it's two sides or multiple sides courses of action. And that's what really called high-level information fusion. Unmanned vehicles. I don't know what time it is.
10 minutes.
10 more minutes. Okay. Doesn't matter when I stop. Just it can go for us. You may not aware of this. Of course, now it's a very fashionable topic. That airplane pilots are very afraid to fly among unmanned vehicles, unmanned aircraft. They just don't know what to expect from them. So even if they are on the same team, but nowadays it's a really important problem. At that time it was not so many unmanned vehicles, but nowadays it's really dangerous. So we could provide linguistic geometry tools on board of aircraft, manned and unmanned, so that pilots of course will be aware of what is going on and what to expect. simulation-based acquisition, I already mentioned, is regarding aircraft carrier, regarding other projects. For example, the most recent nowadays, the missile defense is interested in this because they test their anti-missile interceptors, and they want optimal construction of this. So we can provide all this. I'm not sure if this project will go too far, but we actually started. Resource allocation. It would take forever to talk about this because that's what we've been doing for Boeing at the beginning and been doing several times. And nowadays, I kind of generalize this. As I mentioned, it provides new domain for linguistic geometry and applied it to ancient battles, actually battles of Alexander the Great and Hannibal. So when the battle starts, there is a start state of the game, if we model as a gaming problem. So there could be a problem of optimizing the start state. When should we start the battle? If you recall maybe that typically in the ancient times, armies don't start the battle immediately. They approach and one of the armies may go away, may start maneuvering. And the army, the other army may be pursuing this or maybe still go away. So the point is that they choose the location, the resources, the timing for optimal start. And the actual battle start when both armies decide that it is the time. So it depends that each of these armies decided that this is the optimal start state. So linguistic